The Federal Capital Territory Administration has announced the discharge of 30 COVID-19 patients. The Minister of FCT, Mohamed Musa Bello, disclosed this on his official Twitter page on Saturday morning. According to him, the patients were discharged after they tested negative twice to coronavirus. This brings the total number of recovered patients in Abuja to 245. To give us more insight on the latest figure of COVID-19 confirmed cases, it's medical practitioner Dr. Chika Onuka, who joins us via Zoom. Thank you, Dr. Chika, for joining us on the news.
Thank you very much.
And how are you doing this afternoon?
I'm very good. Very good.
Good to know. Now, just like many Nigerians feel unconcerned about these figures coming from NCDC, to the extent that some insist that it is a scam, what's the feeling among medical practitioners on this last scale of ignorance and indifference?
Well, it's a sad thing that Nigerians still have many people who feel it's a scam. The truth is that it is not a scam. Whether people choose to believe it or not is a different thing. It's not a scam. The privilege or the opportunity we have or the grace we have, let me put it that way, that the severe cases that we have from it doesn't appear to be as it is in a lot of the other countries that have had very bad situations, should not make us to dwell in ignorance and dismiss reality. It is not a scam. As I speak, I have many friends, many colleagues, many beloved friends, from all walks of life, who are physicians and who at the moment are sick. I've been spending time talking with them, chatting with them, encouraging them, supporting their family. And many people are doing that as well. That somebody does not have it should not make the person to feel that it's a scam. It is reality. And so amongst the medical profession, we know it is reality. We are feeling it. We are having challenges with it. We have friends and colleagues who are down, and the rest of us are fighting.
Now, Dr. Onuka, as a medical practitioner, you just rightly said you guys know it's not a scam, but what do you think could have informed this notion amongst the general populace? Could it be any on the side of the federal government? Is it an action or inaction of the federal government that could have given people the rise to doubt the existence of this pandemic?
I think that people are listening beyond what people hear from federal government. They're listening to the news, there are things in social media. There have been people who have listened to those who have had the infection, but hearing the rest of what we hear, there is quite some stories that are out there. And that come from those who have not had an experience. And learning from social media does not mean learning the correct thing. So that is affecting the information that is out there. And then, I don't think it's a problem of the federal government, really, or federal Ministry of Health or any of the agencies that are supporting it. I think they've been trying to communicate the same thing and raising the alarm. I think it's just that a lot of people don't believe it, and not believing it is because they have not seen it. We remember when there was a monkeypox case, the picture of someone with monkeypox that went around on social media got people scared. And because people don't seem to be hearing that kind of scary thing anymore, they've slowed down, but it hasn't gone away. And I think we should just do our best. I will ask that those who are in the information setting, those who have responsibility to share information, to share correct information. I don't think it's just about federal government.
The presidential task force briefs the president before the president takes action. In other words, the doctors and the team are part of the decision making. Could it be that reopening the economy is the realistic step that must be taken?
For a country like ours, and knowing where we are in terms of our GDP and the status of our economy, it is clear that, it was clear that at some point we had to draw the line between the beneficial effects of like a lockdown and the hazards, you know, the side effects of also doing that. Yeah. And, you know, if there's no money to invest in more test kits, more treatment centers, people might say, okay, let's allow people, allow the citizens recover a bit. And I think that's what has been happening. And so the medical professionals are part of the decision-making process, from what I see, and those who are involved. But of course, it appears to be a realist perspective of the thing, of the decision process, that the economy cannot collapse because, you know, while we are trying to solve this problem.
Right.
I remember as well that even in households, households knew that they needed to do something more to get funds, to get money back to homes, to get food. And if you don't deal with that bit, if you don't prepare for such aspects, there will be a social unrest. And, you know, people can use anything as a reason for the social unrest. And no government will want to allow that to happen.
Dr. Chima, 328 new infections and 10 deaths in a day. Are the medical workers overwhelmed? And probably, is it a case of no more bed spaces? What exactly is going on?
So, you know how many people die from maternal, that die from deaths from, you know, pregnancy and pregnancy-related issues in a day and on the five children? It's in thousands in Nigeria in a day. Remember that in countries that have less population, like Spain and all that, there were times that they were having like thousands of deaths in one day. Now, we've got 10, and that's from 200 million people or over that. I think to a large extent, it is something that, you know, from my personal perspective, we should be very grateful to God about, that it is like that. Our health system cannot cope if we face the situations that those people outside the country have faced. I don't think bed spaces are fully occupied or the staff are overwhelmed. No, it's that, you know, people are dying from this, and I don't think our numbers have, you know, look like what is outside, even though the desire is that nobody dies from this.
Lastly, Dr. Chima, how practicable and what is your assessment of home treatment of COVID-19 patients who are asymptomatic?
Home treatment of patients who are asymptomatic is not a bad idea. The problem is the context within which you are applying it. For Nigeria, the personal responsibility, if home treatment is allowed, is what the stakeholders have been worried about. Nigerians are not even believing it. You have people who have a cough and they carry themselves and their families and they go to another person's family. They have a cough, they have a flu, they just go to work. You know, you have a friend and you don't sound like it's a problem that you are coughing or something like that. So other places, when they say somebody should stay at home, they just stay at home. Nigerians, many Nigerians will not do that. There are Nigerians who will do that. Stay, even those who, you know, stay quarantined, stay indoors for 14 days. It's a problem, even when food is provided for them. That's the problem. It's a context of application that makes the stakeholders to say, look, we don't want to go this route. And it's the same problem that is affecting like the use of face masks. And people are putting it on their jaws. And it's sad. And I think we need to take more responsibility as citizens of the country to slow this.
Dr. Chima Onoka, it's been a pleasure having you join us on the news. And thank you for your contribution.
Thank you very much.